much, Orla. I do have to apologise to Orla because Orla rang me looking for a young, successful, entrepreneurial speaker, and before I volunteered myself before she got a chance to ask for Brian O'Driscoll. So sorry about that, Orla. So we got chatting anyway, and I said, Orla, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to throw in a few stories about my old rugby days? And she said, Frankie, you can throw in whatever you want, but for God's sake, throw it straight. I see somebody down there didn't get that. I didn't get that either, so that's okay. And apparently it had something to do with my line-out throwing in the day. So thanks for that, Orla. It's pretty intimidating, to be honest, looking at the level of person inside in this room. It's incredible, really. And some of the points I'm going to talk about have come from people in this very room, so forgive me in advance if I feel like I'm standing up here preaching to you. I'm certainly not trying to do that. What I'm going to try and do is share with you a few stories from what has brought me to where I am today. Okay. I was lucky enough to play for Munster in Ireland, 29 times for Ireland. The one thing I'll say about that is playing in the Irish jersey makes you feel 2 inches bigger. That's why my wife makes me keep one under the bed if it's rough, and so that's all I'll say about that, right? My business career, I found myself in 2009 when I retired. I set up a speakers bureau, so we would source speakers for leadership programs, management training, entertainment, hospitality, etc. So we would do 3 to 4 speakers a week, mostly in Ireland, but a lot now in the UK and further afield as well. For example, we would have booked someone like Clive Woodward for an IT company in Florida only a few weeks ago. So we've a lot of potential within this business. I'm on the board of Fort Ireland. I just got appointed a second term, which is it's a great privilege for me to be involved in that. Some of the best marketeers in the country are on the board there, and you know, being a part of the gathering and even the World Cup bid for 2023, listening and the feel about that is great. But also the Wild Atlantic Way, which is something we all should be very proud of as Irish people. And when we go abroad, we should be beating the drum on that. That's the longest coastal road, driving road in the world. So we should all be very proud of that product. For my sins, I get to do a bit of commentary with Sky Sports and RTE. This little tweet was captured there one day. I was commentating on the women's team there. You can hear some of the giggles in the background. And some wise crack came and tweeted this out. I think Gavin might have retweeted it at the time. So it's great. It's something I'm hugely passionate about, the game, and I can go along to the games and get a few bob to cover my expenses and talk about the game I love. So in 2000, about 2 years ago, I always had a passion to do something by going around to the different companies and listening to the great speakers, and I see some of them here, the Gavin Duffys and the Peter Caseys, among others. I hope I'm not leaving anyone out. Larry Bass is down there somewhere as well. And I felt, would it be fantastic to have one event once a year that wasn't just for the banking sector, the legal services, the marketing sector, but it was for everybody. And, bring together a number of people who've achieved great success, if not master in their chosen career, and ask them what the magic ingredients were for them in achieving that great success. So I'm just going to play this little video clip to give you an idea of it.
Success, if not mastering a chosen career, and it's a question asking them what are the magic ingredients for those guys.
So in the next 60-70 minutes, we're going to try and solve all the problems of existence. It's the full day of personal growth, knowledge, wisdom, combined with wonderful technology.
There's such a variety of speakers. And I think what's also unique about it is that a lot of people wouldn't choose to put a conference right in the first week of January of a new year.
It's not often that people take a day out to reflect effectively on where they are in terms of their careers, but not alone actually in their careers, but actually in their lives as well.
The 10th pendulum, you're going to get a bigger view of the year ahead. You're going to be much more ambitious, you're going to demand more of yourself, and more importantly, you're going to enjoy the year better.
But look at it. You know, my reputation grows with every failure. I love saying that because it's true about me. I have had failures.
What I found was a lot of individuals who actually care about making themselves better, holistically.
Today we have 1,700 people, right, amazing, actually all energized about moving forward with positivity.
The passion and the enthusiasm and the vibe that kind of started since 8 o'clock this morning has just been infectious, actually.
Well, it's just absolutely brainstorming of ideas, and I realize I can change my attitude to absolutely everything.
The area that Pendulum was focusing on, which is to do with kind of wellness and meaningfulness and relationships and networking, is just getting increasingly important in the sort of business lives that we lead, but doesn't get as much attention as perhaps it deserves.
You've got a very good fusion of, you know, inspirational speakers, business speakers, entrepreneurs, fabulous snippets from different leaders across different walks of life.
The energy, the motivation, the empowerment, the feel-good factor from it is just absolutely tremendous.
Coming here is only the first step. The question
is, the county angels, I mean, you could almost see you could change your life.
I'd like to thank Orla as well. She did a fantastic job for us on the day, comparing the day as well. And I laugh at Brian's modesty earlier. I saw a fantastic article, and I read that in the paper recently about your ascent. So just well done on your own success there, and what a wonderful building. Give him a boule of boss there, guys. So I stand up here in front of you guys, and you know, I feel very successful economically. Not there yet, right? But in every other sense of the word, I'm a father with 5 kids, I have a great family, good support network around me, hugely passionate about the companies and what I do. So I feel very lucky to be in that place. But if I'm very honest with you, I have to share with you that it wasn't always like that. I go back to my rugby career, and yeah, I got 29 caps, and please forgive me again if I feel that I'm not grateful for what I got, but I got 29 caps. I grew up with Ronan O'Gara, he got 128 caps and went on 3 Lions tours. For me, I felt at times I was cursed, that I didn't get the breaks that I deserved. And, you know, I had some horrific memories actually within my rugby career, which it baffles some people when I share that with them. I had 7 operations, 5 of them on my knee. I had a heart ablation to correct atrial fibrillation. I came back and I played for a year after that. I had a pec injury here that finished my career in 2008. I had a neck injury that the doctor said I should have died, the neurosurgeon, and that I'd never play again. Somehow I managed to come back and play afterwards, but the timing of these injuries were terrible, really terrible for my career, so the disappointments were desperate. The lowest point of all was I arrived on an Irish trip to Australia, and I got a call to Brian O'Brien and Eddie O'Sullivan's room, who were the manager and coach at the time, to say, Frankie, you need to come back. You were drug tested after the Munster-Toulouse semi-final, and you've been tested positive for salbutamol, which was the inhaler I had been taking. I said, well, I take my inhaler, what's the big deal? And they said, apparently, that there's a problem. The form, the exemption form with the box that was supposed to be ticked wasn't ticked. Either way, you have to go back and answer the charges. Again, just when I was about to go and earn another few caps and maybe make the position my own, I had to get called back. To say we went in a bit blasé about it, we obviously didn't have William Fry representing us, because we went in and we felt that this was crazy, because on every other form, I had, he was well known. I'd been on salbutamol since I was 9 months of age. And so we thought this was just going in, that this was going to be in and out. I was given 2 years before, immediately, to say that, that I couldn't play for 2 years. Now, for somebody whose value system would be integrity and honesty, this was the most horrific time, I think, of my life. I mean, to be accused of something like this, and I would say if somebody is found guilty of taking drugs in sport, they should be banned for life. And here I was defending myself and given a 2-year sentence, if you like, right? I was lucky that I was able to have the resources, that I was able to, we left no stone unturned on the appeal. It was immediately thrown out and they saw for what it was, you know. But again, it was another time that was really, really difficult. Shortly after retiring in 2009, as a rugby player with a short career, I invested a lot of money in property because that was going to be our pension right when I retired. And as Robert Frost so eloquently put it, my bank, who had given me an umbrella in the fine weather, decided to ask for it back when it started to rain. And it didn't just start to rain, as we all know. There was thunderstorms and a very, very challenging time. So here I was again, finding myself in a position that I wasn't just fighting to keep my pension, I was fighting to keep the roof over my children's heads. Why am I telling you all this? You're supposed to be getting an uplifting chat this morning. I'm telling you this because, as Deepak Chopra said, in every failure lies the seeds to success. And as strange as this might sound, I'm very grateful for all that adversity that I've gone through, because that has created the path to where I am today. And again, I'm not saying I'm a big economic success, but I'm certainly in a good place at the moment, and I'm very thankful for that. So with that in mind, I've put together 10 areas here that I have, through my experiences on the rugby field, through my experiences listening to guys like you, and I've pulled these together, and I've called it, in the topic order, Springboards to Success. So with that in mind, I mean, embrace adversity, right? The Buddhists actually pray for adversity in their lives. I wouldn't quite go that far, but I mean, all the great people, they talk about it. Here you have Malcolm X talking about it. There's no better adversity. Every defeat, every heartbreak, every loss contains its own seed, its own lesson on how to improve your performance the next time. And it's trying to see the positive in every adversity, okay? You have someone, the famous YouTube clip of Steve Jobs when he talks about, it's easy now when he looks back, but he can connect the dots, but you just need to have faith that the dots are connecting looking forward. And with that in mind, I just want to play a small video, which, again, turns it on its head. So I just threw that in there. I mean, here we were in a country and everybody giving out about the doom and gloom, and I thought it was a wonderful piece of video that a lot of the state bodies put together, including Fort Ireland, and it's, you know, something I think we should be proud of. Which brings me on to my next point. And we've all heard this thrown around a lot, positive mental attitude, right? Zig Ziglar says, people often say that motivation doesn't last. Well, neither does bathing, that's why we recommend it daily. If we're overweight, what do? We go to the gym. We need to get back in shape and we set ourselves a program. But we don't do this enough mentally, right? The average thoughts for a human, for an adult human being is, I think it's 12,367 thoughts a day. Imagine how dangerous it can be if these thoughts are negative, are disempowering. It can be absolutely brutal, right? And imagine how powerful it could be if these are empowering, positive thoughts, right? So we must control the dialogue in the head, right? So I say, be careful of the monsters in your head, right? You need to monitor them, right? And you need to be active, and you need to get yourself into some form of a little program, whatever it takes. I'm not advocating what someone like Deepak Chopra would say, to say, spend 20 minutes in the morning and 20 minutes in the evening doing mindfulness. That's not practical for me. I have five kids, I'm working around the clock. But maybe 5 minutes every other day is a realistic goal to set, to sit down, you know, spend that first couple of minutes saying what you're grateful for, and maybe the next 2 or 3 minutes just seeing where you want to go and so forth. But there's all sorts of ways around it. I can't remember exactly the context of this lineup, but you'll see it there. Alan Quinlan is in my ear, right, and he's saying something that is definitely a rude word. And it would be something in the context of, Frankie, that fellow shouldered you in the last tackle, you've got to go back and take his head off, right? But we're walking to a line-out, and I need, Paul O'Connell is thinking about the line-out call, and I'm focused on getting that throw right. So which monster am I going to listen to there, you know? And it's a case of listening to the monsters and trying to pick the good ones out. We all have this continuous dialogue in our heads, but just be mindful of it. And I find myself personally at times when you're tired and one or two things go wrong, the bad things become way worse again. So just once you're conscious of that. Interpreting failure. Thomas Edison invented the light bulb after 10,000 attempts. And he was asked by a media person afterwards, he said, Thomas, how did you keep going after failing 9,999 times? And he said, failing? I didn't fail once. Inventing the light bulb was a 10,000-step process. So I think we're very hard on ourselves at times. We have this success fail. But I mean, it's how many people here remember incidences in their own lives where something seemingly terrible happened, only for when you look back now on it to say, actually, that was the best thing that ever happened. So it's a case of trying to have faith that whatever way this is going, it's working out for a reason. Once you're doing all the other right things, just have faith that it's working out for you. The next area is exercise the mind, right? And we've just touched on it slightly. I have a picture of Tiger Woods here. When I was in 2002, playing with Munster, we lost our second European Cup final, and I see some smiles from the Leinster guys down here. And that particular year, I personally had lost 3 finals. We had lost to Leinster earlier in that year in the Celtic League final, and I was totally and utterly disillusioned after it. And Declan Kidney, who was our coach at the time, he said, Frankie, we saw it in me, he knew he couldn't help me anymore. He said, why don't you go to the sports psychologist, Declan Ahern, who works out at UL? And I said, look, Declan, I'll do anything I can to try and change this around. And I went to Declan and he listened to me and he said, Frankie, that's absolutely fine. That's, you know, that emotion is good and you have to listen to it. It's good to be disappointed. But he said, why don't you use the 10-yard rule? And I said, I'll try whatever. And he said, what's the 10-yard rule? He said, when Tiger Woods hits a bad shot, now this is when Tiger was in his element, right? And way before he had this awful disease that he got, you know the disease I'm talking about. Gavin's smiling up at me there. And contrary to belief that Tiger hits a bad shot and gets on with a shot immediately, he doesn't, right? He allows himself the time to put the club back in the bag and walk 10 yards. But after that 10-yard mark, he moves on to the next shot. So he allows himself to bitch, to moan, to complain, do whatever it takes for him to get himself right. And this was one of the most powerful lessons I have certainly learned, because it's so relevant for not just sport. You could use this in a bereavement, you can use this in business. We all have disappointments on a daily basis, and nobody knows how to handle them. Some people move on immediately and they fester, but it's okay to be disappointed, and if things don't go your way, it's okay. So listen to it and move on. So it's just some of the tools that you can use to exercise your mind. And again, I'm not here to preach to you. It's a case of you know yourself what it takes for you. Some people might go for a walk. Other people, as I said, maybe every second day, do 5 minutes, listen to audiobooks. If you have a limiting belief, which a lot of people here have, and I'll talk about that in a while, what is the limiting belief? And identify what it is and see a professional to get rid of it. I saw a hypnotherapist when I was having the jitters of my throwing 13, 14 years ago. And I saw a hypnotherapist, and a very simple technique through visualization was able to, he found that when I was going to throw it, you play it out in your head, and when I was going to throw the ball into the nine out, that I was getting all the horrible memories. So what he did was he replaced those horrible memories with, Frankie, think of the best time that you ever remember, the best throw you ever did, describe the surroundings, the atmosphere, everything. And he was able to make sure that I switched into that zone every time I went to throw a line out from then on. And that can be applied, and it was fantastic, and that can be applied to anything. We applied to any of your you know, weaker elements. You know, you don't like going to meetings, you don't like doing this. Well, you can do that. You know, so basically what I'm trying to say is I don't know what will work for you, but there's plenty of help and there's plenty of methods out there. Do what's right for yourself. The next area is responsibility, accountability, and excuse-itis. Part of the real success of Munster rugby, in the height of Munster rugby, was the passion and the attention to detail and the insatiable appetite to improve, right? Nobody cared in the video sessions after about what you did well. Everybody wanted to hear, what can we get better at? It was ruthless, right? And I remember one particular day that, again, it was another loss to Leinster, actually. We lost 10-5 to Leinster in Musgrave Park. And there was one critical try that O'Driscoll, I think, went up the middle in between Ronan O'Gara and Lefimi Maffey. And we were going through the whole video session, everyone was really hard on themselves, and it came up where this critical point in the game, which cost the game ultimately. And Declan Kidney said, we'll deal with that, I spoke to the individuals involved. And Paul O'Connell said, well, hold on a second, what happened? And Declan said again, he said, well, look, I've dealt with the individuals, it's fine, that won't happen again. That's not good enough, Paul said. Now, this is a bit of a confrontation where Paul gets into this mode inside the room. It's kind of, everybody's on the edge of their seat. There's nobody safe. And eventually, anyway, okay, do you want to talk about it? So O'Gara said, look, well, what happened there is Maffey came up too much from the line and allowed the gap, and he went through that, and sure, that's what happened. Maffey said, no, hold on a second, no. That's not what happened. You should have been up off the line with me. You were way behind. That allowed him the space to get in. And all of a sudden there was a bit of a tit for tat, and the defensive coach came in and he said, well, actually what you should have done is ABC. But the point being is that, you know, it's all well and good kind of moving on from things, but you've got to address what the problem was. And yes, when it's stinging and a bit embarrassing at times in front of a big group, it's very, very important, because it's going to happen again if it's not addressed. And we all needed to learn that, and despite, you will have those confrontations, but I think it is worth it. Excuse-itis. There's a guy who's written a book, David J. Schwartz, The Magic of Thinking Big. It's a very good audio book, actually, you should download. It's only 7 or 8 euro. But he talks about excuse-itis, and we mentioned earlier about the limiting beliefs that a lot of people have here. And I mean, how many people go around saying, I don't have enough time to do that, or my health isn't good enough, or I can't do it because. We all have so many excuses, right? And what he's trying to do in this book is just address it, the excuse-itis, and say, I can't do it because I'm too old. And he gives an example of Ronald Reagan getting into his first term of presidency, or his term of presidency, at nearly 70 years of age. My health isn't good enough. You know, and he talks about Franklin D. Roosevelt, who spent most of his life in a wheelchair. I don't have enough time. Well, Warren Buffett, Dennis O'Brien, Gavin Duffy, Frankie Sheahan. Guess what? We all have the exact same amount of time of the week. And some decide to use their time differently. So try and avoid excusitis. Great people avoid excusitis. And you know what? They don't hang around with people who are constantly using excusitis. Because as we know, excuses are the currency of failure. And there's an excuse for everything if you want it. Challenge conventional wisdom, right? I've taken the one here from Roger Bannister on the 4-minute mile. Now, if you can for a second, just try and put yourself back into 1954 and you read an article in a paper where an expert says that this is actually dangerous beyond belief and it can't be done. You know, and here he goes, Roger Bannister, and breaks the 4-minute mile. The interesting thing after that, within 3 years, 27 more people had broken the 4-minute mile. So don't just accept what people say, you know, whether it's Munster can never win a Heineken Cup, they're never going to have the resources. You know, whether it's the Pendulum Summit is never going to be a success because it's the wrong time of year, there's no market for that here, Frankie. You know, you've got to challenge it. No, there's some things you can challenge. I mean, you've jumped out the window here, you're going to hit the ground. You know, let's be real. But Michael Flatley, does anyone know here what Michael Flatley did differently? The conventional wisdom was Michael Flatley, you have to keep your hands down by your sides. He did one thing differently. He left his hands go up in the air. And that has been the difference for him. He was able to jump more, he was able to put on a show. He challenged the conventional wisdom. Teamwork, and I have here, teamwork needs to be redefined. It's all great and managers are all, we need to work as a team. I have a guy, a business coach who comes and does a lot of work with, you know, Electrolux and Nokia and BT worldwide, and he walks into a big conference and he says, teamwork, what a load of bollocks, right? And at this stage now, the HR director and the CEO look over at each other and they're kind of, it was your fault, right? And they're, where is this going, right? But actually what he goes around to saying is that we can try and tick the boxes too much, but I mean, he gives the example of Johnny Wilkinson, right, because he's an English guy, but he says, you know, do we all need to stand around Johnny Wilkinson out in the park and watch Johnny Wilkinson practicing his place kicking? And the answer is no, right? And he says, how many people here have attended conferences at the other side of the world that have nothing to do with them, and all the hands raised? How many people here are on conferences calls on a daily basis that have nothing to do with them, all the hands go up? So while teamwork ticks a lot of boxes and it's a, you know, we all like to talk about teamwork, we're all in this together, actually, like, it's about having a shared vision, right? And it doesn't matter if everybody's working individually, but if it's all reaching that shared vision, that's the most important part. So I just kind of put here, it needs to be redefined. And it's okay to have a bit of healthy competition between you as well. Everyone talks about the Munster thing and the Cork and Limerick. And I'm very worried about it all going to Limerick, to be honest with you, because it was a very good healthy competition between the two centres, I would have felt. So it's about that shared vision, which is very important. Leadership is another thing that gets thrown around an awful lot. There's over 100,000 books on Amazon on leadership, right? And I'm going to summarize them there in the next 60 seconds. I did a diploma in leadership in the IMI there at the end of last year, and I thought it was absolutely fantastic. And one of the gurus in leadership is a guy called Daniel Goleman, right? And you'll get this article anywhere. He talks about the 6 different styles of leadership. And what he would say is the great leaders are able, the way a golfer knows what club to hit in every situation. Some situations he'll take a bit more time to consider what club do I need for the context of this situation. But great leaders are the ones that are able to adapt the different clubs to the different context and the different style of it. Joe Schmidt, one of the great leaders, one of the most impressive people I've ever seen, met, and done business with. I mean, he does speaking engagements for us. What a lot of people wouldn't know is that Joe gives every penny to charity, you know. He's got a son who's, epilepsy, and I know that's in the public domain now, but every penny he does, and he'd ring me and say, Frankie, you know that gig with Intel or someone like that? He'd say, you know what, it doesn't suit me, but that'll buy 2 wheelchairs for the charity down there, so I'm going to do it. So he is wonderful the way He's able to adapt his style. He comes in front of the camera after a match, and he's so gracious, and he's able, some of the previous Irish coaches used to be kind of, you know, the enemy against me. He's embracing the questions. Joe, your tackling wasn't good out there. You know what? You're right. Well, I wasn't happy with it. There was a few areas, and you're right. And he's just a lovely, mild-mannered way. Then he goes back in, and he's on the pitch. He's a lunatic. He's a lunatic. And he does not accept second best. When he first started in Leinster, he had an awful start. And they lost again to Treviso, so they had one game in four or something, they had one win in four, and they were doing the video session after, a bit like I was telling you earlier with Munster, and there was one particular clip that Treviso spilled the ball, they were attacking, spilled the ball, ball arrived out to Gordon Darcy. Darcy ran up the pitch, stepped a guy, passed it, poor pass, down at the knees of O'Driscoll, knock on, and Joe played this clip. And he said, right lads, do you want to talk me through this? And Darcy put up his hand and he said, yeah, you know what, good turnover, got the ball in, I stepped your man, thought of his arm, poor pass, sorry, my fault. So Joe said, okay, anyone else? There's this big silence like this, and Trico kind of, you know, still sat up in his seat and said, yeah, you know, it was definitely on, you know, and good step by Darcy, but yeah, poor pass, yeah. Joe stopped and he said, Trico, you're a world-class player. I've seen world-class players catch those passes. Right? And Joe talks about for the next 2 seconds, felt like an hour, that there was a silence in the room. And he said, in that moment, he didn't realize Trico was as big as he was until that very moment. And Trico could have finished him, as we know, but to Trico's credit, he said, you know what, Joe, you're right. I could have caught that pass. And from then on, it developed a culture, according to Joe, within the squad that, you know, you can catch those and you're a world-class player. And they actually became a bit of a joke in the culture. So as a leader, Joe Schmidt is an incredible guy, you know, and it all goes very well. You know, the game, there's a very good article, actually, somebody took notes on one of his speeches recently. If anybody wants it, just give me an email after and I'll send it on to you. But the New Zealand game, which we should have won, we all know, and Joe was asked about that afterwards, and he said, you know what, the head of referees worldwide said that it wasn't a penalty, but you know what, he said, you know, again, he was going away from the excusitis. He said, you know what I was more disappointed about was the next six or seven phases where our body position over the ball wasn't good enough for our tackle technique, because that's the difference between winning that breakdown and getting turnovers. I mean, that is just incredible. Not to be able to just jump in and say, yeah, the head of referees, we all would have done that. I certainly would have done that. And to be just big enough to be able to do that. So he's an exceptional guy. Change your goals to muss. Okay, we all have these goals, and goals are fantastic, you know. I feel that goals are getting a bit flaky. I think people, I'd love to live in that place over there, but there's no timelines to it. This is a Tony Robbins comment: change your goals to must. Have you all heard of Tony Robbins? I hope you have. He's coming to Dublin soon. No hint there, but anyway, change your goals to must. Okay. And because a goal, if I want to do two events next year, one in Dubai, which I'm just back from, and one in London in May and September next year, if I say that's my goal and I'll to do them, but if I say I must do them, there's a huge, huge difference, right? And I think it's very powerful. You should try that. This is just another one. I think it's very topical, and I just wanted to play it. It's a 2 minute video clip on Jordan Spieth after he won there the last major. And just to give you an idea, the power of goal setting.
At 14 years old, Jordan Spieth can hit a golf ball better than any recreational golfer ever will. The Jesuit sophomore to be is also the top ranked.
Have been together for almost 2 years, and during that time, I was lucky enough to do a gig with JP McManus recently, well, it's a couple of years ago now, and one of the things he said was, I don't care who you are, everybody should spend 5 minutes every day at the start of the day writing out what you want to achieve in that particular day, right? So you have your short, medium, and long-term goals, which is your vision we spoke about earlier. You can't see this, but don't worry, right? This is a performance matrix that's used in sporting terms with the names down here, and across the top it is how many carries you had, how many tackles you had, you know, how many rucks you hit and so forth. And the beauty about it, having something like this, is that if I have 8 tackles this week and I look at this, it's a great way of motivating yourself, because you can say, well, I'm going to have 9 next week. So by setting goals and targets, it activates your motivation. Culture of innovation and constant improvement, it's huge. Today's giants will become tomorrow's dinosaurs unless they respond for a need to change. And it is not survival of the fittest. It's actually survival of the best able to adapt, because as we know, the dinosaurs went extinct. So it's been able to have that that agility to be able to change with the things there. The two examples here. When we were at the height of it with Munster again, if Phyllis are here, is he going on about Munster again? But anyway, a lot of people think, yeah, you learn from the people who are better than you, and absolutely you do, and the companies who are better than you. We learn from everybody. We used to play a team and we might have beaten Treviso 60 points to nil. But we'd be in the dressing room after and I'd say to Paul or something, you see that line out they did? That was a brilliant line out. And we would take that line out from them and we'd call it Treviso. And we'd use that, and we're always looking to improve from everybody, even the people who are seemingly below you as well. And just with the example too with Nokia, in 2007 Nokia were a €10 billion dollar company. Right, within 5 years, it had collapsed 97%, right? And it wasn't just their competition. You know, we have to be aware that those sectoral boundaries are collapsing. Their competitors came from the outside as well. So you just need to be constantly in a space and watching your blind spots. My last point here is probably the most important one. And in successful people I have seen, this is a culture amongst them. There's a book called The Science of Getting Rich, written by Wallace Wattles, and he talks about there being a law that if you do everything in a particular way to the best of your ability, whether it's up here speaking, whether it's sending an email, whether it's meeting a person, whether it's the relationship with your wife, if you do all those things to the best of your ability, it's like the law of gravity. You fall out the window, you hit the ground, you can't but be successful. And it's 100% right. And I just want to play one small video here, right, and this will kind of back up where I'm going with it.
In the meantime, we're back. I don't know what to say, really. 3 minutes to the biggest battle of our professional lives. All comes down to today. And either we heal as a team, or we're going to come inch by inch, play by play, till we're finished. We're in hell right now, gentlemen. Believe me. And we can stay here, get the shit kicked out of us, or we can fight our way back into the light. We can climb out of hell. 1 inch at a time. Now, I can't do it for you. I'm too old. I look around, I see these young faces, and I think, I mean, I made every wrong choice a middle-aged man can make. I pissed away all my money, believe it or not. I chased off anyone who's ever loved me. And lately, I can't even stand the face I see in the mirror. You know, when you get old in life, things get taken from you. I mean, that's part of life. But you only learn that when you start losing stuff. You find out life's just a game of inches. So is football. Because in either game, life or football, the margin for error is so small. I mean, one half a step too late or too early, and you don't quite make it. One half second too slow, too fast, you don't quite catch it. The inches we need are everywhere around us. They're in every break of the game, every minute, every second. On this team, we fight for that inch. On this team, we tear ourselves and everyone else around us to pieces for that inch. Because I'm still willing to fight and die for that itch. That's what living is. The 6 inches in front of your face. Now I can't make you do it. You gotta look at the guy next to you. Look into his eyes. Now I think you're gonna see a guy who will go that inch with you. You're gonna see a guy who will sacrifice himself for this team. Because he knows when it comes down to it, you're going to do the same for him. That's the team, gentlemen. And either we heal now as a team, or we will die as individuals. That's football, guys. That's all it is. Now, what are you going to do?
There's a few fellas getting up after chairs there as well. But that isn't, that's football. But actually, that is life. With the success of anything, what is it down to? It is down to the success of whatever it is in your life. The pendulum summit. Is it down to Deepak Chopra? Is it down to Orla Carmody? Is it down to the convention center, the venue? It's a combination of all, every single one of them, all added up. And that is the difference, in my opinion, in everything we do. Right. I think I'm just on time there. That's just a little recap of the 10 areas. Forgive me again if I felt like you've been preached at. I've the utmost respect for everybody in this room. I'm all for connecting, and I'm all for business cards. I have a bunch of business cards here. So what I'd like to do as well, just to thank you, I'd like to offer you a gift as well of the pendulum members area, right, where you can see the speeches from the day. And that's my gift to you. And I'd just like to thank you again for your time. Cheers. Thank you.